Okay, good afternoon, everyone, and a huge thank you for joining us today. Today is the third webinar in our post-2020 series, and the title for today's webinar is Two Sides of One Coin, taking up the challenge to address both the global climate and nature crises together, most effectively by exploring the linkages between them. So that's really what we want to do today. We've got some exciting presenters on the line, and we just want to, at this point, welcome everyone. Just to mention that the webinar will be recorded and the recording will be made available to all those who have registered after the time. And we are going to run the presentations. We've got four presentations today. And at the end of the presentations, we'll open the floor for discussion and questions. So we ask that you keep your questions till the end, and at which point there will be two ways in which you can ask questions, either by typing in the chat box or by raising your hand on the panel on the right. So thank you for joining us. And without further ado, we will get started. So on today's agenda, we'll have a bit of an introduction and progress to date in terms of the local and subnational government constituency and the roadmap to 2020. And that will be presented by Ingrid Kutsier, the Senior Program Manager of the ICLEI City Biodiversity Center here at ICLEI Africa. Then we'll follow that by a presentation that in this morning's session was presented by Eunice Arakan, the head of ICLEI Global Policy and Advocacy. Unfortunately, Eunice is unable to join us this afternoon, but we will be playing back a recording from his webinar this morning when it's time for that slot, which will look at the global picture and the global links at the CBD and UNFCCC level on the linkages. After which, we're excited to have Renata Gomez with us from Regions 4, and she's going to be presenting some thoughts from a regional perspective, as well as the outcomes of a learning platform event that Regions 4 recently held on the same topic. And then finally, we will have a presentation by Joel Park from TNC, and he will be sharing some exciting work that TNC has done in the space. And as I mentioned, after that, we'll have some time for questions and discussion. So without further ado, I'm going to hand over to Ingrid. Thanks, Ingrid.
Thank you, Tim. And hello to everybody. So I'm just going to very quickly just give an update of where we are on the local and subnational government roadmap to China. We've had a series of very important events already this year. We're halfway through the year. You will see from the slide in front of you, there's a reference to the regional consultations that the CBD organized in the first quarter of this year that have really taken place. There was also the important publication of the IPBES 7th plenary assessment report, which was presented at their plenary meeting in May. And we've just recently had a session on the post-2020 at the Nature of City Summit, which was held in Paris earlier this month. And we are next week heading for the Resilient Cities Congress, which is going to be held in Bonn, and where there are several sessions that are dealing with the topic of nature-based solutions, nature and climate, etc., and gathers cities and their partners and representatives of expert groups from all over the world. So in the slide, you will see where we are today, which is the red box, the third seminar webinar. And what is lying ahead of us are some really important key milestone events in the roadmap to COP 15 in China next year, towards the end of next year. Firstly, there is going to be the ninth Trondheim Biodiversity Conference, which takes place in early July and is held in Trondheim, Norway. And then slightly later in the month of July, there's an important gathering of metropolitan authorities taking place in Medellin, Colombia, where they are going to be specifically addressing different aspects of metropolitan governance insofar as biodiversity is concerned. Then the first open-ended working group meeting is taking place in Nairobi in August. And that's a really important meeting because that is the first time where parties and their partners and stakeholders will be given an opportunity to engage with the more substantive aspects of the new global biodiversity framework going forward. And then later of this course of this year, we have in November, both the SAPSTA 23 meeting and then the Working Group 8J11 meeting as well, which will be taking place in Montreal. And then just to highlight some few things, as I said, at the TNOC summit in Paris, there was a session on post-2020, and that gave rise to a statement or a position that came out of that, which essentially talks to the common roadmap for cities, metropolitan areas, local and subnational governments towards living in harmony with nature. And then another important event that I can just mention to you is that the informal advisory group on mainstreaming biodiversity, which has been established to advise the executive secretary of the CBD and the Bureau, had its first kickoff meeting in last week, the 13th of June. And that consists of around 30 people that are representative of 15 parties and 15 organizations. And of the 15 organizations, ICLEI represents all of subnational and local governments on that working group. Then the other thing that's also worth mentioning is that the Cities with Nature Commitment Platform, we are in the process of designing that. We're having a series of discussions with a range of people, including people from the SCBD, the Secretariat on the Convention of Biological Diversity, some experts, etc., in terms of how that will take shape. And we hope to have that up and running within the next couple of months. ICLEI is also starting work on a draft position paper, which will initially focused just on the position of cities and local governments with regards to the global biodiversity framework, which we hope to have ready by August this year. And once we've got the necessary political support and buy-in from our internal structures, we will, and also presented it at the open-ended working group meeting in Nairobi, we will take it out for engagement with our partners, Regions for Biodiversity, Regions for the Committee of Regions, the Goals Group, and a range of other organizations such as the IUCN, TNC, etc. So we have a process for that position paper as well, leading up to COP 15 in Kunming, China next year. And the last point just to make is that there is a global partnership on local and subnational action for biodiversity, which comprises of two advisory committees, the one on subnational governments, which is chaired by Regions 4, and the other one on cities or local governments, which has been dormant for some time, but we are in the process of reinstating and re-establishing that, and we hope to be making a very exciting announcement about that in the middle of July. I think that sort of sums up the major events, Tim. There are a lot of other things as well, but I think for the purpose of the update, that will be good for now. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Ingrid. So that is a snapshot of where we are in this important process. And I think just on Ingrid's last point on the advisory committee, we'll hear more about the regional committee when Renata presents. So if technology will allow us now, we are going to move over to Eunice's presentation from this morning. And I'm going to just let this play for a while. So as I mentioned before, this is by Eunice Arakan, the head of ICLEI Global Policy and Advocacy. And it's a brief presentation on the global picture in terms of the linkages between climate and biodiversity at the global level. So I trust it will work.
Great. Thanks, Timothy. It's really a pleasure to join this community and command the work of Iclea Cities by the Earth Center. And I think it's a really important agenda that we're discussing today, the synergies between the climate process and the biodiversity, especially in the post-2020 framework negotiations. I'm addressing you not only in my capacity as the Iclea's advocacy head, but also I'm the focal point of local governments and municipal authorities constituency to the UNFCCC. In that sense, it's not necessarily a vision of Iclea, but also the collective activities we're doing as such. So in this presentation, I wanted to limit ourselves to how are we engaged in the climate process and what are the cross-cutting issues. I think the after this discussions, there will be a clear with all the participants, other speakers, to map how we will make sure the best out of it, because we're talking about I think more from now on around 18 months of a process that will really be a very intensive process. So let's start with where we are in the Paris Agreement, because the process is particularly different after Paris Agreement, because in the we all know these are the three Rio conventions, legacy of Earth Summit, biodiversity, land, and climate change. Whereas these three conventions were born out of this Agenda 21, local Agenda 21 was a chapter. Unfortunately, in the text of the UN Climate Convention, there was no reference even to any stakeholders. And although in the implementation there are constituencies which is representing the nine majors of the Agenda 21, in official documents there was literally nothing to any of the stakeholders, and that was our advocacy that we started starting from 2007 onwards, when the nations decided to write a new regime under the UN Climate Change Framework Convention. That was at that time Bali Roadmap, that was turned into a Copenhagen summit. It was always exciting for us because we said that, well, there's nothing to us in UNFCCC, there's nothing on the Kyoto Protocol, let's make sure the third time the same mistake is not repeated. So that was our vision, that we had all mobilized all of our resources. It took a long time, not necessarily from local governments, but the world was having challenges with Copenhagen. During this process, we had used our opportunities as an advocacy through constituency. We had started to be much more actively in the negotiations, the UNFCCC negotiations, and the climate summit in 2014 was a major opportunity for all change of the mindsets. So compared to the UN biodiversity process, where you started to write a decision on cities in 2008, then with an action plan of a COP, that is far, far well advanced than what we have in the climate change. But of course, you all know climate is much more political, much more complicated. So the good news, as we said, in the Paris Agreement 2015, now we have a preamble, which is this is a document that is signed by heads of state. There is a reference to preambular paragraph which says importance of engagement of all levels of government. And the this all levels of governments, again, subnational governments or local governments, different terminologies, it is referred in adaptation capacity building loss and damage. In the Paris Agreement, there is another document that is more a COP decision, which is the implementation of this Paris Agreement. There is a clear chapter called non-party stakeholders. And there we are referred as cities and other subnational authorities. Previously we had the word of governmental stakeholders, but now the wording in the UNFCCC is cities and other subnational authorities. Again, this is different than the terminology used in the biodiversity framework. These are just comparative things, and I think it's helpful for us to understand. There we have much more clear engagement opportunities, and that's what we have been building on over these years. Again, another difference is that the climate negotiations are much more intensive, or used to be much more intensive. We don't know how it will evolve in the next couple of years, but one key difference is that in the biodiversity you have it every 2 years, whereas in the climate we have every year. And in every year the conference of parties is going one of one part of the world. What we are noticing that we have a consistent, let's say, three-prong engagement, and then we have priorities for each year. The difference is that there is certain style that doesn't change too much, but every COP, because of the priorities of the host city or country, and the political priorities of the process of that specific year, we have to change our, or at let's at just fine-tune our priorities. In every year, what we do is that, first of all, we showcase our information about what local and regional governments are doing on climate change, because we know that this is independent from what decisions comes up. This is mainly through our data reporting platforms. ICLEI has been running the Carbon Climate Registry and since 2010. And this year we have merged it with CDP. So it is a CDP and ICLEI joint reporting platform, which will be feeding into the UN climate reporting platform as well. Then we have our own side events, summits, the one similar to you, what you have, and regularly global summit of local and subnational governments. In our case, the terminology may be different, the format can be different, but we definitely have side events and summits. Then we participate in the consultations, there are workshops, we are invited as a constituency, and there is a new initiative called Marrakesh Partnership, which is a bit more action-oriented. And then we participate in the decision-making, we submit documents, we the agenda items, we make interventions, and we use effectively the national government's delegations through the Friends of Cities, and you are familiar with that, both climate change and biodiversity and all other multilateral environmental agreements. It is a party-driven process. Therefore, the final inputs to the text should come from the parties. And in that sense, we would like to use with those friendly countries, and this is also expanding now, there is more and more recognition of urban and climate community. This year in Chile, we will be in December. We will be focusing on the NDC, the nationally determined contributions, which is the climate strategies of national governments. There is a discussion on local climate finance, and we will continue to raise our ambition because of the urgency and climate emergency now coming up, and the pathway to climate neutrality. We should be focusing on it much more clearly. I'm showing this. This is the priorities of the presidency of the COP, which will be held by Chile, which is a Latin American country. As you can see, they have mapped seven areas, and one of them is biodiversity. This is, of course, an extreme opportunity, which has not been the case before. There has not been that much emphasis to biodiversity by any presidency so far. So this, of course, follows the global recognition of biodiversity framework. This means we could expect much more concrete outcomes from the biodiversity, from the climate COP this year. That is exciting us, of course. Once again, every year it's an intensive cycle, 12 months compared to 24 months. It is led by the presidency, the previous COP, and then the next one. Here you have the leaderships. But in the middle of it is the mid-year, the consultations in Bonn. That is, again, a difference. This is, there is, wherever the COP goes, they always come back to Bonn to have a mid-year term, a mid-year assessment and review. And that's where it is important to be actively involved, because we are based in Bonn. Mayor of Bonn is president of Bonn, president of ICLEI. And we have a strong relation with the secretariat as well. And you'll see a couple of more updates on that. Over these years, the thing that has changed a lot is that we had Talanoa dialogues as a legacy of the COP hosted in Bonn in 2017. In 2018 especially, this was an opportunity because for the first time, the climate targets were discussed by civil society or stakeholders. This was a mandate from the COP, and it was again our success of advocacy, because original plan was that dialogues would be held only once and it would be held only at COP. Now it is, throughout the year, it was held everywhere in the world, because the proposal that was adopted was changed because of our inputs as well, that it would be held every city and every local subnational region. So we had, as cities and regions, 60 sessions in 40 countries. And some of them was really, really very ambitious in terms of the collaboration with the national governments. Africa shined up, having the most of them. And this was the first time to bring Paris Agreement home. How to make make the NDCs fit for Paris Agreement. And that is an opportunity because this process has led to a new decision saying that, okay, use this experience to improve your NDCs. That is the biggest achievement we had over the past years. The key agenda, how we are now running it, is this year will be our engagement through LGMA. May, June was very heavy. There is UNFCCC process, which to this month is particularly important. But that there's other UN processes. And as you have seen in 2020, we mapped biodiversity as well. But meanwhile, we also have the COP of the land degradation in India in September. So from now until 2020 biodiversity COP, it will be a couple of series of three COPs, or let's say there will be four COPs of three conventions of Rio. This is important. These are the land COP in India, the climate COPs in Chile and possibly in the UK, and the China COP of biodiversity. This gives a huge opportunity for us to make the inputs and outputs from each of those helping each other so that by the end of this, end of 2020, we can come up with a much more meaningful thing. Of course, the one of the interesting things is the Climate Action Summit that will be held this year. And this is important because this is also having a work stream on nature-based solutions. This is, and again, that we have highlighted in Sharm el-Sheikh, that is an opportunity for the nature community. And I think it's resonating a lot, but we have to be actively involved because the process is not very easy. The both the biodiversity community and the climate community of local regional should be actively engaged. And that should be one of the priorities, how to map this in the next couple of days. A couple of outcomes from again, climate community. City of Bonn is implementing an interesting project called Beethoven Pastoral. The logic is that Beethoven has composed an important symphony, pastoral symphony. That is, of course, Beethoven is well known with his ninth symphony, which is an invitation for peace, universal peace. But pastoral is also a peace between man and nature. So Climate Change Secretariat and City of Bonn has kicked off this in 2017. But the goal is to have between Earth Day 2020 and the Environment Day 2020 from April to June, series of concerts or cultural events all worldwide that highlights the value of nature. What we are saying is that ICLE is now joining this process and would like to bring this as an awareness raising to post-2020 biodiversity process as well, because we know there is a difficulty, there is a challenge that biodiversity community is suffering, that it is not getting the right attraction in terms of awareness and visibility. So this could be a good opportunity that brings climate and biodiversity process again. Last slide, as is mentioned, resilient cities, we will have the IPES global assessment, one of the co-chairs addressing the closing plenary. And this would be an opportunity for us to advance further. And here in Bonn, there will be a very important high-level event, and we will kick off the debate to a new phase. And from Friends of Cities, we are going to Friends of Multi-Level Action. That is much more meaningful because we have understood that there is now a better recognition for collaborative action. And we hope this would also support our work along these lines. So this is the end of my presentation. In the PowerPoint, you would see links to our previous webinars. We are also having monthly webinars. Our the latest document report, the key decision from Katowice as a background information. But I think with this input, I can conclude my presentation so that we can have a discussion from this webinar on, but probably more importantly, after this webinar, when everybody now gets together their ideas and insights, then we can come up, and I think Cities by their sense of ICLE would lead this process on the way forward. So I thank you a lot for your patience and interest.
Okay, so I think a big thank you to Yunus in his absence, and I hope that the sound was clear on that presentation. And that everyone could hear. It's our first time playing back a recording, so I hope technology was kind to us today. So thank you, Yunus. And as Yunus mentioned, we will follow up with all the presentations and the links to the documents that have been mentioned so far, and that will be mentioned in the coming presentations. So I think on that note, we're very excited to have Renata Gomez with us from Regions 4. And as you can see, this is their brand new logo on your screens. They've just rebranded, and we're very excited to be working very closely with them in our post-2020 work. So Renata, thank you for joining us, and over to you.
Thank you very much, team. Like you said, yes, this is our very brand new logo and that we're presenting. Yes, so as Tim was saying, Regions 4 is a network of regional governments. And if you move on to the next slide, I can let you know. Yes, thank you. So we work the climate change and biodiversity arena from a regional perspective. So we represent subnational governments in these two fields, additionally also on sustainable development. And to be more specific on the biodiversity dossier, we coordinate the Advisory Committee on Subnational Governments to the CBD and host a community of 12 regional governments who that is called Regions for Biodiversity Learning Platform. We get together and exchange information, lessons learned, good practices, and come up with solutions to common challenges together. We also elaborate documents and reports that we submit to the CBD through the advisory committee, the same way that Ingrid just mentioned that they are the coordinators of the advisory committee on cities. Next slide, please. So our work with the advisory committee is pretty interesting for today's topic, because we are currently preparing our inputs for the next SUBSTA and also the other global processes that I will comment further today. So what we are preparing to do is to, and our core objectives are to advocate for regional governments at the very heart of the CBD. We promote dialogue between advisory committees and the parties to the CBD. Actually, on the previous SUBSTA, we organized a side event that was attended by Korea, Japan, Mexico, and Canada. And these four parties were there to observe and see the development and the actions on the ground that in that moment we presented at the SUBSTA. We also strengthened partnerships to support subnational actions on the ground and also empower leadership and collaboration among advisory committee members. We intend to foster or to do this work by, like I said, supporting our work with other partners like the Regions for Biodiversity Learning Platform or even the group of leading subnational governments to the Aichi Biodiversity Targets, also known as GOALS. So the upcoming opportunities that I would like to mention are also very crucial for today's topic, because mainstreaming biodiversity into climate change policies is also going to be, as you know, a highlight on this conversation. So as Ingrid mentioned, the Trondheim conferences on biodiversity that will take place in July in Norway are a great opportunity to engage with the parties and to influence the discussions being held at that forum. Additionally, the first meeting of the open-ended group working group on the post-2020 global biodiversity framework that will take place straight after the conferences in Trondheim will take place in Nairobi, Kenya. And of course, like I mentioned, the 23rd meeting of the SUBSTA in the very end of November in Montreal. So we as Regions 4 and as coordinators of the advisory committee are taking a strong participation in these three events, and we are going to be sharing our common message, a message that was elaborated at the heart of the advisory committee and that regions have been working on for the last few months. Also, we are hoping to present a report at the at Substat 23 related to mainstreaming in practice and at the regional level of government. So this report, and if you move on to next slide, I can tell you a little bit more detail. This report hopes to identify capacity building and training needs for mainstreaming biodiversity at the subnational level of government. Also, opportunities to develop partnerships with the private sector, indigenous people and local communities, and other stakeholders. Mechanisms to monitor implementation and obstacles that block mainstreaming of biodiversity into policies such as climate change. So this document is a work in progress and is actually open to leading subnational regions willing to make an impact on the CBD discussions that are going to be held at the next Substat. Also, it's a good way to get together and hear from other regions on how they solve the challenges that they face. In many cases, like I was saying, the challenges are common for everyone, and this report intends to do just that, to present common solutions also to these challenges and to speak to the CBD and to the parties about to make these decisions on mainstreaming biodiversity. Like I was saying, next slide, please. We're going to be sharing on this report some practical cases. It is not going to be a collection of case studies, but rather a collective conclusion of all the practical experiences that we have gathered. And I would like to present today one that is particularly interesting for mainstreaming biodiversity into climate change policies, because it involves the work of many different actors. It is the Quebec's Biodiversity Monitoring Network, a project that started in 2016 that has the objective of identifying changes in ecosystems to support decision-making processes. So this project is the result of a joint task force between the Ministry of Forestry, Wildlife and Parks and the Ministry for the Environment and the Fight Against Climate Change. So the way this project is implemented is that they select biodiversity interesting sites throughout Quebec in order to ensure accessibility. They then integrate existing monitoring systems in the region and include protected areas. So protected areas, which are very important in Quebec, are also considered in this selection of sites. And they also, as a next step, select and develop biological indicators that respond quickly to changes in different environments, including forest, tundra, wetlands, and aquatic environments. The interesting part of this project is that next slide, please. Is that it gathers also on these monitoring of biodiversity actions, it gathers the support of the local communities and the indigenous peoples. So in 2018 and 2019, 40 to 50 sites were sampled with the help of the Inuit indigenous people. So a partnership with the Nunavik parks and the Inuit communities that were present in that area was developed to allow the monitoring of various sites in the north. A monitoring process that wouldn't have been able or so successful without the aid of the local inhabitants and of course the owners of traditional knowledge and the ancient knowledge of the biodiversity of the region. So it's interesting to see these cases. The session of the learning platform that is going to take place on this specific topic is happening next week, and it's open only for regions for biodiversity learning platform members, although the platform itself is open for for interested regions in working together to exchange information and technical knowledge to solve these, like I said, similar issues on the ground. This is my last slide. So finally, yes, you can see my contact information over there. I will be happy to further send you more information or invite you to one of our sessions. So the invitation is open for everyone to join us and come visit us at our new website. Thank you, Tim. Over to you.
Great. Thank you so much, Renata. We really appreciate you joining us today. And I hope everyone enjoyed that presentation. And as Renata mentioned, her details are on the screen right now. And we're very excited to hear of the outcomes of the Learning Platform event, Renata. So thank you very much. At this point, we're going to hand over to Joel. And Joel is from the Nature Conservancy, and they are one of our founding partners on our Cities with Nature initiative. So yeah, we've been working with Joel for a while now, and we really are so grateful to have him join us today. So Joel, thank you for joining us, and over to you.
Sure, thanks, Tim. So this picture I always like to include of some power lines, literally dissecting a 70 plus year old tree. I think it really kind of sums up the challenges of development and climate change and nature and in a very visual picture. But Tim, if you could go on to the next slide. So if you know the Nature Conservancy, you probably know us as a fairly traditional land conservation organization, which is certainly our history and much of our work. But we also are very active in the climate change space and increasingly in the city space, which I'll talk about. But when it comes to climate change, we've done a lot of work around assessing and demonstrating the role that natural climate solutions can play in both climate mitigation through sequestration and through adaptation and resilience building. And in terms of mitigation, we did a report that assessed and found that there's simply no way we can get to 1.5 degrees without bigger investments in natural climate solutions. So you can see down here, that includes both protecting existing natural assets, better management of resources, and then also restoration as a big part of that. But it's about a third of necessary emissions reductions we believe can be met through investments in natural climate solutions. Next slide. And these solutions, like I said, come through a range of sectors. Traditional conservation, avoided tropical deforestation is a huge component of that, but also blue carbon and working with indigenous peoples as land managers of their own lands and some of the best managers of lands. In forestry and working lands, and ag lands, as I mentioned, we believe that there are ways to meet development demands more sustainably through improved forestry practices and soil health practices that we believe we can feed 9 billion people in the world without significantly new agricultural lands if we better manage and increase productivity where we are, thereby capturing more soil carbon. So this is something that is really multifaceted a lot of times, and including ourselves historically talked only about that tropical forest solution, but actually it's really many sectors where you can see mitigation gains through natural climate solutions. Next slide. And so following on the heels of this report, we were part of a founding the Nature for Climate Coalition. Nature for Climate, you can see the logos here. There's additional groups involved as well. And it's really looking to help push the world to invest in these natural climate solutions, both through processes like the Paris Agreement and through the UN system, but also through working with the private sector on zero deforestation and low carbon supply chain work, as well as working with consumers in general on behavior change and education and awareness. So it's a broad sweep. We're not targeted on just one of those sectors, but working at all sort of levels to push the message about natural climate solutions. Next slide. Again, just showing with policymakers, we are focused, as I said, on the UN Convention, and as well as in certain countries on different approaches in the US here, also in strengthening where natural climate solutions show up in NDCs as we try to ratchet up ambition. We're working in a handful of countries there. With corporations, there's been some good pledges made by major parts of industry, Unilever, Walmart, Bunge, others, but we have yet to really see those pledges turn into action. And so that's, the coalition is working with those companies that we think are taking sincere steps and making sincere pledges, and trying to work through how we can actually help them achieve those ambitious goals. Investors, this is one where we think there's a lot of potential as more investors look to see climate risks fully show up in their investment decisions, that natural climate solutions can be a way to drive money into climate-friendly investments, climate-friendly forestry and agriculture, and also in resilience investments. So encouraging, just even in the last year, encouraging progress where investors are waking up to looking at climate impacts in their portfolios. And then, as I mentioned, civil society, working with groups, like all the groups on this call, as well as with a large part of our work here is with Indigenous peoples groups to make sure that their voices are represented in these global forums, and as well as in our interactions with national governments and the private sector. And then work that we're doing on messaging and communicating to the general public about consumption and choices and how that can have an impact on climate and nature. Next slide. So where this comes together with the city's agenda for us is a report that was released last November at the CBD COP. ICLE was a partner in this report, as well as several other groups, Stockholm Resilience Center, Future Earth, the Natural Capital Symposium. And what the Nature and the Urban Century Assessment was trying to do is to bring together these two trends, climate change, but also urbanization, and or three trends really, and then biodiversity loss. So the report really set out to look at where future urban growth will most impact global habitat. So where urban growth will impact current existing intact habitat. What fraction of the world's protected areas will potentially be impacted by urbanization? What are the carbon emissions related to habitat conversion through urban expansion? And then also where there's some natural habitat or natural asset that's providing an adaptation or resilience benefit that a city may not be aware of or properly valuing in their resilience planning. So the report looked at about 150 cities and regions globally. I encourage you all to Google and download the full report, and then the website has lots of interactive maps and tools where you can zoom in on particular regions. But just some of the key findings and why we think this is such a compelling nexus here as we try to solve sustainable urban development and climate change and biodiversity loss. Rate, and we've all heard these numbers quantified in various ways, but the urban population is growing at a rate that's a new London about every 7 weeks, and in terms of people, and then in terms of infrastructure, we'll urbanize an area about the size of the country of Colombia by 2050 if you were to push together all the new infrastructure that's going to be built. So a huge chunk of land that will be converted in the next 30 years. And in terms of habitat, we want to understand if this was what the trend was, if this was growing or declining. And so looking from 1992 to 2000, urban growth was responsible for about 190,000 square kilometers of lost habitat. Looking forward from 2000 just to 2030, it's going to be about 290,000 square kilometers of natural habitat. So we've seen urbanization having a growing impact on habitat and biodiversity, but we think that we can begin to bend that trend line down. And then in terms of carbon storage, urban growth in a business as usual scenario would destroy habitat that stores an estimated 4.35 billion tons of CO2, which is the equivalent of just under a billion cars on the road for a year. So a huge climate impact, absent all the new infrastructure, the new concrete port, et cetera, just from habitat conversion. And then when you talk about adaptation, by 2030, just over 10 years from now, urban area is forecast to more than double in low-lying coastal zones, which is the ecosystem where you see some of the largest resilience benefits from biodiversity and natural habitat. So we have a growing number of people in a disaster-prone area, looking at sea level rise and typhoons and hurricanes, that are building over one of their best and most resilient adaptation investments. So as an example of where we're working with cities, Melbourne, Australia, just last week launched their Living Melbourne plan, which the Conservancy, along again with many partners, was a part of helping the city to develop. So Melbourne, you know, prides itself appropriately as being the greenest city, the most sustainable city. It's a value they really do live. And so a few years ago, when they set out to look at their resilience planning as part of the Rockefeller 100 Resilient Cities program, they saw a potential joint stress around loss of their urban forestry for biodiversity's sake, but also from a climate adaptation and heat, urban heat island way. So they commissioned this Living Melbourne Urban Forestry Management Plan to look at where their tree canopy could best, investments in that tree canopy could best serve those two goals. So from biodiversity, it's not just wanting to be a green tree-filled city, but they also have significant biodiversity both within and just outside of their urban core. There's over 300 species of songbirds in Melbourne. They've seen massive water quality improvements in recent years. They want to maintain some of the biodiversity that's returned to their freshwater sources. And so next slide, Tim. So you can't really tell much from this map. So again, I encourage you to look up the full report. But we worked with many partners at the request of the city to develop this urban forest management plan, which we a process that we refer to as green printing, but there's many others working in this space where there's different approaches and different terminology, but the key takeaway is that we're trying to help cities move from thinking about nature as an amenity, as a parks and recreation sphere, and move it into thinking about it as a piece of infrastructure that is serving those adaptation and resilience benefits, also serving public health benefits, but actually as something that is not a nice to have for their city, but a must have, and then financing it the same way they would traffic signals, fire hydrants, roads, sidewalks. And so if we can make the case that nature is infrastructure that's just as important, vital as gray infrastructure, we hope that cities will begin to invest in it as such. So Melbourne, I know, is one of the lead cities in the Cities with Nature platform. And again, they're very proud of their leadership in this realm. And so we hope to see other cities looking at what Melbourne has done and the really forward-thinking approach they're taking and get more cities interested in doing the same. I'll stop there, Tim, and look for questions or comments.
Great. Thank you so much for that, Joel, and thank you for joining us. And as Joel touched on, Melbourne is one of our pioneer cities on Cities with Nature, and Cities with Nature is actually an implementing partner in the Living Melbourne framework. So we're very excited to be involved in that process as well. So Joel, thank you for your presentation. And I think at this point, I'll just take the opportunity just to thank all four speakers. Eunice in his absence, Ingrid, Renata, and Joel, thank you for joining us both this morning and this afternoon. We've really appreciated your input. And now we're going to open the floor for discussion or any questions. As I mentioned at the beginning, there's two ways in which you can do this. You can either raise your hand on the panel on the right or type a question in the text box on the right as well.
Hi, Joel, it's Ingrid here. I just have a question about the Nature for Climate platform initiative. Just to maybe if you can elaborate a little bit more on how it works and whether there is any specific contribution that is going to come from that platform in relation to the sort of post-2020 global biodiversity framework process, as well as the UNFCCC negotiations.
Yeah, so I can't speak in too much detail. There's a whole team of my colleagues that really manage that work. In terms of UNFCCC, as I mentioned, within the formal negotiations, we just work on a lot of kind of on the technical side of advising, rules around accounting for red and deforestation, providing the science and input to some of the technical bodies about the potential for mitigation through natural climate solutions. Where the more of the focus in the UNFCCC side is now at that country level, where we TNC are working in a couple of countries, Mexico, Indonesia, China, I know for sure, I think one or two others, to strengthen the inclusion of natural climate solutions in their NDCs as they look to raise ambition, and then turn that into actual reductions through investments in natural climate solutions. So we're kind of looking at how we can help cities meet their Paris commitments through natural climate solutions at the country level, and then, as I said, kind of in a variety of technical roles and the convention level. On the CBD side, I'm less sure. That team has been so focused on the UNFCCC, but as TNC ramps up our work towards COP15, we certainly want to make sure that we're making the case, especially in that mainstreaming dialogue that you mentioned earlier, Ingrid, that the Biodiversity Convention is giving itself the credit it deserves for contributing to climate goals as well. So specific actions within the CBD, I'm not sure. I'd check with colleagues, but it's something that we are working on there.
Thanks, Joel. Are there any other questions at this point? Okay, it doesn't look like there are any questions. Are there any final words from any of the speakers before we end?
Just maybe from my side, this is Cody Brunt. I work with Ingrid and Timothy at the Ecclesiastes Biodiversity Center. I think, this particular webinar is part of a series of webinars focusing on different aspects of preparing us for our constituency's position paper on the subnational constituency's position paper towards COP 2020. And what we are certainly seeing here is a momentum building up through these webinars, where so many organizations and so many individuals from organizations, key individuals, are coming together and sharing information and updating us on what they're doing. But also, as we move forward, we will be looking more and more, not just as at different linkages, like today we focused on the climate link, but certainly also on what we'd like to see from a city's perspective and from a subnational perspective in general, the world to be in the post-2020 era. So thank you very much for all your contributions, and we look forward to deepening the discussions from I think next month onwards. We will move towards content issues in terms of the different drafts that we will be putting out there on behalf of the subnational governments and our coalition of friends. And thank you very much to all the speakers that are contributing, not just today, but are also following these webinars. And if you did miss it or you want to share it with colleagues, please be reminded by Tim. I'm sure you'll do it just now, Tim, that these are available on social media as well. So thank you very much. This certainly enriches our thinking as part of our drafting process of the position statements.
Great, thanks, Kubi. And as Kubi mentioned, we will be sharing not only the webinar recording, but a number of different resources that have been mentioned in the webinar as a follow-up to all those who have registered. The webinar itself will also be posted on the ICLEI and Cities with Nature YouTube channels as well. So you're welcome to check them out there as well. So a final thank you to everyone for joining us. I hope you've enjoyed exploring the links between climate change and biodiversity with us today. And we really look forward to welcoming you to our fourth webinar, which will take place in July. And until then, it's been wonderful. So thanks everyone for joining, and we will chat soon.